Professor Dave here. Let's talk about Lyme disease.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
You may have heard about Lyme disease on the news or on TV and wondered what it was about. Lyme disease is a bacterial infection acquired by the bite of an infected tick, which classifies Lyme disease as a vector-borne illness. As we mentioned in an earlier tutorial, this means that the infection is transmitted to humans by a mosquito, tick, or flea. The disease itself is a little complicated, presenting itself slightly differently depending on the person and the stage of disease. Generally speaking, though, early Lyme disease symptoms include headache, chills, fever, fatigue, joint aches, and swollen lymph nodes. In addition, about 70 to 80% of infected people experience a bullseye-shaped skin rash called erythema migrans. If left untreated, Lyme disease can spread to the heart, joints, and the nervous system, causing symptoms like nerve pain, spinal cord inflammation, arthritis, facial palsy, severe headaches, and shooting pains in the tendons, joints, muscles, and bones. Because early symptoms are so similar to that of the flu or other diseases, Lyme disease can be difficult to diagnose and isn't always reported to state health departments. There's still a lot that we don't know about Lyme disease, especially in the case of long-term infections, but let's get a closer look and talk about what we do know. Lyme disease is an infection caused by a corkscrew-shaped bacterium, also called a spirochete, named Borrelia burgdorferi. There are at least 10 related species of Borrelia that can cause Lyme disease in animals and humans. Lyme disease was first studied in 1977 when a cluster of children with arthritis were found in Lyme, Connecticut. In 1982, Willy Burgdorfer linked the strange disease to the spirochete, and the medical community honored his discovery by naming it Borrelia burgdorferi. These bacteria are gram-negative and have multiple flagella that give them their characteristic twisting motility. Genetically speaking, these bacteria have a linear chromosome, which is quite unusual in the bacterial world, in addition to a large number of smaller DNA molecules, or plasmids. Interestingly, these bacteria don't have the usual virulence factors, which are the factors that many bacterial pathogens typically have to cause damage, such as toxins or lipopolysaccharide. Here's where it gets extra tricky, so pay close attention. B. burgdorferi infects a wide range of small mammals, birds, and lizards. Ticks, particularly black-legged ticks, transfer B. burgdorferi from these vertebrate animals to humans. This is the only documented way for humans to get infected by B. burgdorferi. Let's talk more about those ticks. In the U.S. in particular, the black-legged tick, also known as deer tick, or more formally, Ixodes scapularis, spreads the disease in the Northeast, Mid-Atlantic, and North-Central regions of the U.S. The western black-legged tick, Ixodes pacificus, spreads the disease on the Pacific coast. Ticks can attach anywhere on the body, especially hard-to-see areas. Most commonly, it's the smaller, more immature versions of ticks, called nymphs, that infect humans because they're more difficult to see. It typically takes 36 to 48 hours of attachment for the Lyme disease bacterium to be transmitted. To diagnose Lyme disease, doctors test for certain antibodies that the body makes in response to infection. However, it can take several weeks or even longer for antibodies to develop, which can lead to a negative test result even if a patient has been bitten by an infected tick. To make things more complicated, antibodies can hang out in the body for months or years after the infection is gone. And if that's not enough, there are multiple other diseases, viruses, bacteria, and autoimmune conditions that can give a false positive result for Lyme disease. If all this gives you a headache, you're not alone. However, scientists are working tirelessly to learn more and develop newer, more accurate tests to diagnose Lyme disease. In the meantime, the best thing you can do is try to limit exposure to ticks and stay extra vigilant about checking for them after outdoor excursions. So after a hike in tall grass, you know what to do. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.